Professor Ibeli Duwolayinka, FAS. For the first time in the history of this university, we also have the father of our inaugural lecturer in this assembly, a professor of agricultural economics of this university, very distinguished Professor J.K. Olayemi. Again, today's lecture is entitled Rocking the Cradle, the Pressure, and the Punks. And it will be delivered by very distinguished Professor Oladapo Olugbenga Olayemi, a professor of obstetrics and gynecology, Faculty of Clinical Sciences of this university. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, you may wish to join via Zoom. And the meeting ID for Zoom is 910-4421-0530. Again, the meeting ID 910-4421-0530. And the passcode is 991-735. Passcode 991-735. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, may we rise for the academic procession.
College, the Dean of Clinical Sciences, Dean of other faculties and of students, directors of institutes and centers, heads of departments, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. The 506th University of Ibadan inaugural lecture will be delivered this evening by Professor Olayemi of the Department of Obstetrics and Gynaecology on behalf of the Faculty of Clinical Sciences. To Professor Kayode and late Mrs. Anike Olayemi at Ilesha, he attended St. Franciscan Nursery School, Ilesha, for his early education, International Nurture Research Institute, Onireke Ibadan, for his primary education, Fatima College, Ikire, for his secondary education, and International School, Ibadan, for his A-level studies. He was admitted to the University of Ibadan in 1984 and bagged the MBBS degree in 1989. He obtained a Master of Public Health from the Johns Hopkins University with the Bill and Melinda Gates Scholarship as a Gates Fellow in 2006. He joined the academic staff of the Department of Obstetrics and Gynecology of the Faculty of Clinical Sciences, College of Medicine, University of Ibadan on the 1st of June, 1999 as lecturer grade one. He was promoted senior lecturer on the 1st of October 2002, reader in 2005, and professor in 2008. Professor Olayemi has served the university in various capacities. He served as sub-dean postgraduate, head of department, director of the newly established National Institute of Maternal and Child Health. He is co-director of the College of Medicine, London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine Research Collaboration Center, established for clinical trials on reduction of maternal mortality. Outside the University of Ibadan, Professor Olayemi is an examiner of both the West African College of Surgeons and the National Postgraduate Medical Colleges. He has served as external examiner at undergraduate and postgraduate level to at least 10 universities in Nigeria. He has also served as external assessor to many universities, both within and outside the country. He has served as a consultant to several international organizations like John Hopkins Program for International Education in Gynecology and Obstetrics and Pathfinder, and to the Federal Ministry of Health to produce and revise guidelines and training curricula for all cadres of health workers, thus improving maternal and child health. Professor Olayemi's research interest is in reproductive health, especially in fetal maternal medicine, and his work has focused on improving the understanding of postpartum hemorrhage and pre-eclampsia and reducing mortality from them. He has received funding from Wellcome Trust and Mercator Foundation for studies that have been a subject of numerous well-cited publications in literature, notable among which are the use of tranexamic acid in reducing postpartum hemorrhage and the application of psychosocial support in labor. These studies have led to a revision of the World Health Organization guidelines for the management of these conditions. Professor Olayemi is a fellow of the West African College of Surgeons from 1999, fellow of the National Postgraduate Medical College 2002. He is a founding member of the Association of Fetal Maternal Specialists of Nigeria and the current editor of the Society's journal. Professor Olayemi has published over 100 peer-reviewed articles in reputable journals and over 20 abstracts in books of abstracts. He has co-authored both books and chapters in books. He has also attended and presented papers at several international conferences. He has also mentored and supervised fellowships and PhD candidates through the residency programs of the West African and the National Postgraduate Medical College, the Pan-African University, and Consortium of Advanced Research and Training, CATA, in collaboration with the University of Ibadan. He is married to Dr. Onikekwe Olayemi, who is an alumnus of this university. So far, they are blessed with three promising children. Ini Oluwa, Anyofe Oluwa, and Anu Oluwa. It is my privilege to call on Professor Olayemi to deliver his lecture titled Rocking the Cradle, the Pressure and the Pants. Professor Olayemi.
Deputy Vice Chancellor Academic, Deputy Vice Chancellor Research, Innovation and Strategic Partnership, Registrar, Librarian, Provost of the College of Medicine and of the Postgraduate College, Dean of Faculty of Clinical Sciences, Deans of other faculties and of students, Directors of Institutes, distinguished ladies and gentlemen. I begin today by thanking God for the opportunity to deliver the 506th Inaugural Lecture of the University of Ibadan on behalf of Faculty of Clinical Sciences, and the fourth for my Department of Obstetrics and Gynaecology. I have a rare privilege of delivering an inaugural lecture at the University of Ibadan, just as my father, Professor Jake Olayemi, retired, did on the 3rd of March, 1988. His lecture was titled, The Nigerian Food Equation Towards a Dynamic Equilibrium. This was the first inaugural lecture I attended, and it inspired me to diligence and excellence. He's sitting here today, just like I did 3 years ago, and it is indeed a rare privilege, and I don't take this for granted. Daddy, I wanted to be an agricultural economist like you, but you gently guided me to study medicine. Thank you for all your advice and fatherly care over the years. I also stand behind great scholars in my department who have delivered this lecture. My teachers, Professor Oladipo, who delivered his lecture titled Reproductive Failure in 1981. Professor Ayefo Dewole, who delivered his lecture titled From Womb to Tomb, Protecting the Great from the Crab in the year 2000. I also queue behind my pair, Professor E. Oladoku, who in 2014 delivered the lecture titled Let Thy Daughter Live. Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, I have chosen the title Rocking the Cradle, the Pressure and the Pants for the following reasons. Rocking the Cradle represents my field of obstetrics and gynecology. I am in the business of supervising pregnancies and deliveries to ensure that women deliver safely with live babies that they can rock inside cradles. The pressure represents hypertension in pregnancy and my research to understand it better. The pants, which is twofold, represents the pain in labor and my work on how to relieve it. It also represents the grief of losing the woman during childbirth and my effort to prevent this calamity. The field of obstetrics is said to be the last addition to the four main fields of medicine. The others before it are internal medicine, surgery, and pediatrics. It is believed to have been established in the 17th century by a Frenchman named Francois Mauritius. He was also incidentally involved in early debates about hypertension in pregnancy. Followers of his discourse on the subject have ascribed to him the honor of being the first person to find the association between hypertension in pregnancy and women carrying their first pregnancies. This is a risk factor that has been established to this day. The instrument of diagnosis of hypertension in pregnancy is the sphygmomanometer. The first one was invented by Samuel Sigurd Carl Ritter von Bach in 1881. It was a rubber ball that was filled with water to receive water flow in the artery. It was connected directly to the artery. The water-containing bulbs served to prevent mercury from mixing with the blood. Like the modern sphygmomanometer, the blood pressure reading was still from the mercury column. With the benefit of hindsight, this measurement will correspond to that which you know as systolic blood pressure today. About 14 years later, in 1896, the device was further improved by Scipione Rivarossi. He introduced the cuff that could be affixed around the arm to apply even pressure to the limb to occlude the artery. It has become the standard design for this instrument till today. It thus eliminated the need to invade arteries just to measure blood pressure. It was still only the systolic blood pressure that was measured, however. Modern blood pressure measurement was developed in 1905 by Dr. Nikolai Korotkov. He described the difference between systolic blood pressure and diastolic blood pressure. Systolic blood pressure, which indicated the peak pressure created by the pumping of the heart, and diastolic pressure, which corresponds to the pressure generated by the resting heart in between contractions. He showed that by listening to the appearance and the appearance of sounds after completely occluding the brachial artery and releasing the pressure slowly, it is possible to identify these two parameters of blood pressure. These sounds are now known as Korotkov sounds. The use of systolic and diastolic blood pressure is now standard in blood pressure measurement in clinical practice, with millions of these readings taken daily all over the world, all thanks to Dr. Nikolai Korotkov. With advances in technology, many versions of the sphygmomanometer now exist. Some of them do not require the mercury column, and many of them easy to use at home. This has revolutionized the management of hypertension. But this newer instrument should be validated with the mercury sphygmomanometer. Preeclampsia is basically defined as hypertension with proteinuria. The history of hypertension will not be complete without knowing how proteinuria was linked to it, and to define disease entity called preeclampsia. The first description of proteinuria was by Pierre, a Frenchman in 1840, who described the presence of proteinuria in eclamptic women. In 1843, John Lever, an Englishman, and J.Y. Simpson, a Scotchman, specified that it was indeed a disease different from Bright syndrome, as it resolves after delivery. The discovery, however, significantly improved knowledge about eclampsia. Also in 1843, Al John described the premonitory symptoms of eclampsia in women presenting with proteinuria. The most common premonitory symptoms are headache and the perception of flashing lights, which are still relevant in clinical practice to this day. In every generation, the belief of theories frame the practice as basis for treatment of hypertension in pregnancy, especially preeclampsia. Treatment was yearly based on the four human theory of Hippocrates. He described the body as being made up of four fluids, namely blood, phlegm, yellow bile, and black bile. The imbalance of one or more of these fluids is believed to cause disease, including hypertension in pregnancy. More interesting is the theory of the wandering womb. Many female ailments were attributed to the wandering womb. Central to this theory was the belief that the uterus was able to physically uproot itself from its seat in the pelvis and travel anywhere within a woman's body in search of satisfaction. This search for etiology of protection of pregnancy and preeclampsia is still going on, but has evolved over the years. Hypertension is defined as systolic blood pressure equal or greater than 140 mmHg of mercury and or a diastolic blood pressure equal or greater than 90 mmHg of mercury, taken at least 4 hours apart. This is because blood pressure should be repeated to confirm true hypertension. But if hypertension is severe, then blood pressure should be confirmed within 15 minutes to avoid delay in offering appropriate medical care. The most crucial factors introducing error in measurement of blood pressure are inappropriate cuff size, taking cuff over the clothes, not resting for 3 to 5 minutes before blood pressure is measured, heightened the emotional state during measurement. There's also evidence regarding a share between full bladder and errors in blood pressure readings. These factors should be considered in interpreting the blood pressure readings, especially before the pronouncement of a patient as hypertensive. When hypertension occurs in pregnancy, it is important to determine if there is a share of proteinuria. Proteinuria should be assessed initially by dipstick urinalysis, which is the minimum standard of care. The gold standard and definition of proteinuria is by a 24-hour urinary protein estimate of 300 milligrams or greater in 24 hours. But most times, due to the urgency of care needed, careful visual sleep analysis will suffice. Using the protein-creatinine ratio is also useful in determining significant proteinuria. Classification. Chronic hypertension is when hypertension is detected before 20 weeks of pregnancy, especially if it persists for at least 12 weeks after delivery. Preeclampsia is defined as hypertension with proteinuria and carries a risk of progression to the development of seizures or what we call eclampsia. Chronic hypertension when superimposed, when superimposed preeclampsia is defined as new onset proteinuria after 28 weeks of gestation in a previously hypertensive woman. Gestational hypertension is hypertension without proteinuria after 30 weeks of gestation. Transient hypertension is a retrospective diagnosis and should resolve within 12 weeks after delivery. My earliest effort in research into hypertension in pregnancy was to establish the magnitude of the hypertension disorder in pregnancy in our environment. The study aimed to determine the incidence of hypertension at booking and at delivery. The incidence of hypertension at booking was 9.8%, rising to 26.2% at delivery, which was a statistically significant difference. Previous personal and family history of hypertension were strong determinants of hypertension in pregnancy. In 2003, we sought to determine the usefulness of microalbuminuria in predicting occurrence of hypertension in pregnancy. 100 healthy, normotensive pregnant women attending our clinic were followed up till delivery. There was an increased incidence of preeclampsia with an increase in albumin secretion. With a single urinary microalbuminuria excretion, estimates at booking, the sensitivity, specificity, positive and negative predictive values were 88.9%, 67.9%, 22.2%, and 98.3% respectively. We concluded that urinary microalbumin excretion, when used as a single test at booking, appeared to predict preeclampsia with high sensitivity but with a very low positive predictive value. We sought later the utility of serum albumin, creatinine, and uric acid in the prediction of hypertension in pregnancy. 59 healthy normotensive primary gravida with secondary pregnancy who booked for antenatal care and delivery at the University College Hospital were recruited. They had single estimates of their serum albumin, creatinine, and uric acid levels at booking before the 28th week of pregnancy. They were followed up throughout pregnancy. Even though the test showed value in predicting the occurrence of hypertension in pregnancy, the predictive values of this test was low, whether alone or in combination. The International Federation of Gynaecology and Obstetrics, FIGO, initiative on preeclampsia gives the following guidelines on screening for hypertension in pregnancy. All pregnant women should be screened for preterm preeclampsia during early pregnancy by the first trimester. Combined tests using maternal risk factor and biomarker as a one-step procedure should be performed. The women with estimated risk higher than 1 in 100 should be commenced on low-dose aspirin. This figure is just to highlight the detection rates of biomarkers singly or in combination, and just to note that the FIGO combination has a detection rate of about 75%. Hypertension is a disease of theories. The modern theories are based on more scientific observation, but the etiology of the condition is still elusive. The most accepted theories are as follows. The theory of abnormal thromboplastic invasion of uterine vessels postulate that preeclampsia results from defective second wave invasion of the uterine vessels. This theory is supported by abundant histological evidence, as uterine vessels of women with preeclampsia lack the invasion of the vascular musculature present in normotensive women. The theory, however, fails to identify the trigger or the barrier to the failure of this invasion. The theory of maladaptation to cardiovascular or inflammatory changes in pregnancy is based on the mainly inflammatory markers associated with cardiovascular changes in pregnancy. The mediators of these changes are prostaglandins, thromboxane being a vasoconstrictor and prostaglandin is a vasodilator. Usually in pregnancy, the vasodilators predominate, but in patients with preeclampsia, the vasoconstrictors are more abundant. It is worthy of mention that one of the current preventive measures using low-dose aspirin targets this mechanism and provide evidence for this theory. Aspirin works by selectively inhibiting the production of thromboxane, thus enhancing the abundance of prostacycline. Certain dietary excesses, such as carbohydrate, protein, and deficiencies such as magnesium, are associated with occurrence of preeclampsia. The presence of antioxidants in some studies is associated with the reduction in incidence of preeclampsia. We sought to contribute to the body of knowledge in this area by conducting a study to explore the relationship between oxidative stress and preeclampsia in Nigeria women. The study showed that women with decreasing consumption of antioxidants are more likely to develop preeclampsia compared to others. The evidence for genetic influence in development of preeclampsia lies in the fact that preeclampsia has a moderate to strong correlation with family history. In our study on the prevalence of hypertension disorders, family history was a strong predictor of hypertension and preeclampsia. The theory on immunological intolerance is one of the most highly subscribed to by researchers. It is a subject of more publication compared to other theories. Breakdown of immune tolerance may result in sterile inflammation and cause adverse pregnancy outcome such as preeclampsia. Immunological incompatibility between mother and fetus is strongly indicated in preeclampsia. Epidemiological evidence for an immunological basis for preeclampsia includes the increased incidence in primigerive patients, that is first-timer patients. Patients who are pregnant for a new partner, irrespective of having previous pregnancies, those who have prior miscarriages, especially for the same partner. Our research in this area supports immunological theory of preeclampsia. We conducted a cohort study looking at association between previous abortions and an infection in pregnancy. We had the following research question. Would women who had previous pregnancies for the same father as their current pregnancy be protected against infection in pregnancy? If they had abortion, but not for the same father, would they have a weaker protection? Would women with no previous abortion have little or no protection compared to those in other groups of women? Our findings is that having a previous abortion for the same person who fathered the pregnancy carried by the woman gave a 50% protection from hypertension in pregnancy. This study is in keeping and supports the immunological theory for the etiology of preeclampsia. The pregnant woman is exposed to paternal antigens during the process of previous pregnancies. The exposure appears to have caused the immunological system to develop tolerance to the subsequent pregnancy, and this protects the woman from preeclampsia. We now thought of other ways that women can be exposed to the paternal antigen. We hypothesized that a woman with increasing time of unprotected sexual intercourse with her husband before pregnancy will be exposed to his antigen from his seminal fluid. We measured the length of time of unprotected sexual cohabitation before pregnancy. There was a 4% decrease in the risk of developing hypertension for every month increase in cohabitation. This protection is weaker than that was obtained from previous abortion. This also demonstrates a dose-response relationship, which is a condition to causality. From our work on the immunological theory of pathogenesis of preeclampsia, we make the following recommendations. Couples should delay pregnancy for about a year before marriage using non-barrier contraceptive methods. We recommend further research to develop innovative ways, apart from sex and pregnancy, to present the maternal antigen to the female immune system. We think maybe a vaccine will work. Management of hypertension in pregnancy has evolved over time and is strongly linked to the prevalent beliefs or theories about its etiology for the era. It is necessary to understand this evolution to appreciate the leap that we have made in the past 50 years. Prayer, charms, and amulets were the earliest modalities of management. These were based on the belief in the spiritual origin of diseases. Sadly, many of our women are still subjecting themselves to the use of charms and amulets in the care of this condition. Bloodletting is probably the modality that was practiced the longest in history. Bloodletting remained a staple in the prevention and treatment of preeclampsia and eclampsia during the early 1800s. The amount and frequency of bloodletting depended on the strength of the patient and symptom severity. Bleeding from the arm was first performed, but if convulsion continues, bleeding was repeated. In some severe cases, the jugular vein or temporary artery were opened to stop convulsion. Even Frankio Mauritius, the father of obstetrics, recommended 2 or 3 phlebotomies during pregnancy. The use of opiates, warm baths, washing of face with cold water, and hastening of delivery was commenced by Denman between the 18th and 19th century. If bloodletting and opiates failed, splashing of cold water to the patient's face or placement in warm water was attempted. In cases where all treatment were unsuccessful, the physician has to choose between either terminating pregnancy or waiting for spontaneous onset of labor. With the paradigm shift to the toxin theory in the late 1800s, treatment was targeted at eliminating an overabundance of toxins. Those who believed that preeclampsia was caused by meat toxins restricted the consumption of meat and prescribed diets of fruit, vegetable, and milk products. With the recognition of the preeclamptic states, women with headaches and edema were admitted to hospitals where they underwent treatment such as bleeding and purging to prevent convulsions. At the end of the 19th century and early 20th century, two schools of thought have emerged concerning management of preeclampsia. The school of aggressive management with immediate delivery, either vaginal or vaginal section, were located in Germany and the Netherlands, while conservative schools were led by Twidley of Dublin and Strogano of Russia. The conservatists introduced the use of sedatives such as morphine and encouraged the use of obstetric forceps in second stage of labor. But contrary to our current practice, They allow pregnancy to continue, even after convulsion and anticonvulsants. However, the conservatives still recorded lower mortality than those who practiced aggressive management. Magnesium sulfate and antihypertensives. This is one of the greatest strides made in the management of preeclampsia in the past 50 years. The first use of magnesium sulfate was in 1906 by Ohn and by the intrathecal administration, that is, it gave into the spinal space. This mode of administration has since been changed to the intravenous and intramuscular routes depending on the protocol being used. The major evidence for modern use of magnesium sulfate was provided by MAGPIE trial. The College of Medicine of the University of Ibadan participated in this landmark trial through Professor I.F. Adewale as the institutional principal investigator. Several guidelines on the route and duration of use have followed this trial and have been entrenched in textbooks and protocols worldwide. The present full mode of management recognizes that the etiology of the condition is yet to be identified. Low-dose aspirin used for prevention, the use of antihypertensive, magnesium sulfate as anticonvulsant and for seizure prophylaxis with appropriately timed delivery are the cornerstones of the current management. And this represents the giant leaps in the past 50 years. Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, this concludes my discussion on the pressure before rocking the cradle. I will now proceed to my discussion on the pangs. The earliest reference to pain in labor is found in Genesis 3:16 in the Holy Bible. Reading from the New King James Version, I quote, "To the woman he said, I will greatly multiply your sorrow and your conception. In pain you shall bring forth children, your desire shall be to your husband, and he shall rule over you." This statement is made by God, who addressed the first woman, Eve, to forecast her experiences before rocking the cradle. The pain in labor is reported to be the most severe pain most men ever experienced. The relief of pain in labor is as ancient as man himself, with many methods applied to different concepts about the cause of this pain. The use of drugs and physical devices address the physical aspect of this pain. Some other methods have been applied to reduce or modify the psychological distress felt in labor. My interest in relief of pain in labor came from two significant experiences that I had. The first was during my NYC posting. I worked at Wuse General Hospital, Abuja, and as soon as I got to the corridor of labor ward in the morning, I could almost tell the ethnicity of the woman in labor. When I heard shouts and loud groans, I was sure it was not a Hausa Fulani woman in labor. The Hausa Fulani women will have at least an elderly woman with them who will stay till delivery. This was not constantly the case with other ethnic groups. The second experience was during my early residency. I was the registrar in labor ward, and there was a woman in labor shouting so much that the then chief medical director left his office on the ground floor to find out what was going on in the labor ward on the fourth floor. What I remember clearly was that she was alone, as neither her husband nor relatives were with her. These experiences unconsciously started forming research ideas in my mind that shaped my work in this area. One of my earliest original work was on pain relief in labor. We assessed what women knew about pain relief in labor and their willingness to accept pain relief if offered. The questions were, how much do women at the anesthesia clinic know about pain relief in labor? What is their attitude to receive pain relief in methods in labor? And what factors influence knowledge, attitude to anesthesia and labor? We interviewed 1,090 patients. About 27% of them were aware of anesthesia methods in labor. Less than 60% will accept pain relief methods if offered. Older women were unlikely to accept pain relief in labor. More educated women are likely to accept pain relief in labor. Age and education did not influence awareness of labor and analgesia methods. In discussing pain relief in labor, it is important to understand the stages of labor and the origin of pain in labor. Labor is divided into three stages, but the pain is described only for the first two stages of labor. The first stage of labor is from the onset of contraction to the full dilatation of the cervix. The second stage of labor is from full dilatation of the cervix to delivery of the fetus. The third stage of labor ends with delivery of the placenta from delivery of the baby. There are two different kinds of pains in labor, the visceral and the somatic pain. The visceral pain is the predominant pain in the first stage of labor and in early second stage of labor. It comes from internal organs like uterus and the cervix. Chemicals involved in this signaling include bradykinins, leukotrienes, prostaglandins, serotonins, substance P, and lactic acid. The pain is less localizable and likely to elicit severe emotional responses, sometimes incongruous with the severity of the pain. The nerve that conducts impulses to carry this pain from the uterus and endocervix are from the spinal segment T10 to L1. They end up in the sensory and limbic centers of the brain. These nerves, some of these nerves are autonomic that are involved in this transmission. The pain experienced in the late first stage and second stage of labor, in addition to visceral pain, is the somatic pain. It arises from nerves in the vagina, the cervix of the cervix, and perineum because of stretching, distension, ischemia, and injury to the pelvic floor, perineum, and vagina. It manifests during the descent of the baby and because the uterus contracts more intensely, rhythmically, and regularly in second stage. It is transmitted via the pudendal nerves and perineal branch of the posterior cutaneous nerve of the thigh, which are the S2 to S4 nerve roots. And unpredictable. The most common of these techniques are hypnosis, transdermal electrical stimulators on ears, and is believed to have originated in China. Hypnosis as a method of pain relief was started in 1968. The major drawback to this method is the concept of hypnotizability. This refers to the fact that not all individuals can be hypnotized, and this makes it an unpredictable and inconsistent method. The use of pharmacological analgesia for labor pain is recorded in history as being started around 3400 BC, where in Mesopotamia, where opium was first cultivated. It was initially administered through smoking or a weak tea. The pharmacological agents in current use are opioids and inhalation agents. Parenteral opioids are readily available and used to manage the pain in labor. The most widely used is pethidine, which is one of the most effective in labor. In our environment, we use pentazocine, which is very available and almost as potent as pethidine. Due to the risk if side effect profile addiction to the mother, the use of these drugs is limited. I was privileged to review the efficacy of opioids for pain management for the World Health Organization Reproductive Health Library, and this review concluded that the comparative advantage of most of these drugs are not clearly shown compared to the more common pethidine and pentazocine. Owing to the ease of their availability and lower cost, pethidine and pentazocine may be preferred in developing countries instead of the newer, more expensive opioids. The review also was inconclusive about neonatal complication, but shows that pethidine was more likely to cause neonatal complication compared to pentazocine. Hence, appropriate neonatal support should always be in place in healthcare units opting to use these methods for analgesia. The lack of resuscitation support, storage facilities, and control in the primary and secondary health level centers in developing countries may be a challenge to the provision of opioids for labor pain in these centers. To find alternative ways to provide pharmacological pain relief in labor, I participated in some research efforts. We compared intramuscular paracetamol, a readily available drug with less side effect profile, to trimethoprim, which is an opioid. The study compared the analgesic efficacy, patient satisfaction, and side effects of intramuscular tramadol compared to paracetamol. 142 participants were recruited and divided into two groups. The study showed that 600 milligrams of intramuscular paracetamol provided similar modest pain relief in labor when compared to 100 milligrams of intramuscular paracetamol compared to tramadol. Paracetamol had fewer maternal adverse effects and favorable neonatal outcome compared to tramadol. The conclusion is that intramuscular paracetamol is simple, cost-effective, readily available, and a feasible option for labor analgesia, especially in our resource-poor centers. Joseph Priestley discovered nitroglycerin in 1772, and his analgesic properties was provided of oxygen and nitrous oxide, and is the most widely used in most countries. Studies have shown that it is not as efficacious as epidural analgesia, but it is safe for the baby. Other agents are isoflurane, desflurane, and sevoflurane. There are technical difficulties in family and community and the nation. My research activities are focused on relieving this pang. Maternal mortality is defined as the demise of a woman while pregnant or within 42 days after termination of gestation, irrespective of duration and site of pregnancy and the cause of death. The causes are classified into direct and indirect causes. Direct maternal causes result from complications of pregnancy, labor, puerperium, or interventions, omission of, or incorrect treatment. Indirect maternal deaths result from interaction of pregnancy with unrelated medical conditions, which may predate conception or may first appear during pregnancy, labor, or the puerperium. The factors leading to maternal death can be considered as proximal factors, which include these direct and indirect causes of death, or distal factors such as poor healthcare system, poor infrastructure such as transportation, and poor health financing. It includes barriers to empowerment of women, such as poor education, and a commonly used model to describe these three factors is called the delay model. This model assumes that all distal factors affect promises to quality of health care. The three delays recognized in the model are, one, the delay in seeking care, two, delay in reaching proper medical services, and three, the delay in accessing care at a healthcare facility. Most maternal deaths arise from type 1 and type 2 delays. Maternal death is measured as maternal mortality rate, which is the number of maternal deaths per 100,000 women by the mid-year population of women in the community in the reproductive age group of 14 to 49 years. This is cumbersome, as the denominator is mortality ratio, which is the number of maternal deaths per 100,000 live births. This is easier, as data can be obtained easily from the same birth records. Globally, maternal mortality ratio is currently 211 deaths per 100,000 live births. It varies from 2 deaths per 100,000 live births to 1,150 deaths per 100,000 live births. Nigeria has a maternal mortality ratio of 512 per 100,000 live births. The highest contributors are countries in sub-Saharan Africa. They contributed 68% of maternal deaths in the year 2017. The causes of death are hemorrhage, hypertension, sepsis, indirect causes, and others account for the rest. Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, the two commonest specific causes of maternal deaths globally are hemorrhage and hypertensive disorders in pregnancy. I have focused on these two causes in my research and my other activities. I will present my research effort in constituting knowledge in prevention and treatment of postpartum hemorrhage in the last section of this lecture. There has been many innovations in solving the problem of postpartum hemorrhage. Two of the most significant in this are the use of non-pneumatic anti-shock garments and the use of tranexamic acid. The University of Badr was involved in these innovations through research done by members of its academic staff at the University College Hospital Ibadan. Tranexamic acid was invented by Tako and Shoshuke Okamoto in Keio and Kobe Medical Center schools in Japan in 1962. Their intention was to use the drug to treat postpartum hemorrhage. This intention was not fulfilled in their lifetime. It was not until April 2017 that a trial was conducted that made it the first treatment tested in a randomized controlled trial shown to reduce PPH deaths. A simple intravenous injection of tranexamic acid could reduce the risk of women bleeding to death after childbirth. The World Maternal Antifibrinity Trial, Woman Trial, was conceived in Nigeria. Tranexamic acid was used in trauma patients and shown to reduce mortality. The Nigerian surgeons who collaborated on that trial called CRASH then suggested to the principal investigators on the trial, Ian Roberts and Alima Shakur, to test the drug in women with postpartum hemorrhage. Tranexamic acid acts by inhibiting the breakdown of clots called fibrinolysis. By this action, it keeps the vessels closed for longer and therefore reduces hemorrhage. This is the antifibrinolytic activity. The trial was conducted in 21 countries, 193 hospitals, and recruited 20,060 patients. This is the largest placebo-controlled trial of tranexamic acid on record. Nigeria was the highest contributor to the patients in this trial, contributing 5,711 patients from 53 hospitals. Women were randomly assigned to receive 1 gram intravenous tranexamic acid or a matching placebo in addition to usual care. If bleeding continued after 30 minutes, a repeat dose was given. It reduced death by 70% if given immediately bleeding starts, but has no effect if given after 3 hours. The reduction in death was an average of 30% in this trial, since it was given at different time frames. It reduced the need for additional surgical intervention, such as hysterectomy, by 35%. This contributed to the revision of the guideline by WHO on the use of tranexamic acid for treatment of postpartum hemorrhage in 2017. The dosage and timing of administration of tranexamic acid were upgraded in the guideline, This is still one of the most effective interventions for treating postpartum marriage. I was the principal investigator for this trial in Ibadan and a member of the Global Steering Committee on this trial. Evidence is currently being collected in Woman 2 trial for the prophylactic use of pramazinic acid to prevent rather than just treat postpartum hemorrhage. You may also be looking at alternative means of administration of this drug in the near future. My quest to contribute to a reduction of maternal deaths from the two commonest causes of maternal mortality is still going on. Mr. Vice Chancellor, permit me to highlight some of my excursions with my gown into town. I have been privileged to train resident doctors to produce curricula and training manuals for training other kidia or vertical workers by reviewing the following documents: National Training Manual for Maternal and Prenatal Death Surveillance and Response, Life-Saving Skill Manual for Doctors, Midwives, and Community Workers, Community Health Workers Curriculum Review. I've also been involved in writing and reviewing policy documents for the Federal Minister of Health, such as the National Task Shifting and Task Sharing Policy, the MPDSR Guideline, the National Antenatal Care Guideline. I am currently the chairman of the National Steering Committee on Maternal and Prenatal Death Surveillance and Response. I am a member of the National Reproductive Health Tech Care Working Group. Mr. Vice Chancellor, I submit that in these capacities, I continue to contribute to reducing the pangs of maternal death. On this journey, sir, I have been helped along the way, hence my acknowledgement. First, I would like to acknowledge the Almighty God, who through His Son Jesus Christ brought light and understanding to men. I thank my parents, Professor J.K. Olayemi and Ms. Olayemi, for their care and encouragement. My late mother for instilling discipline to me as I was growing up, teaching me the values of hard work and diligence. I also wish to acclaim Ms. Omolola Alade and Ms. Abike Olayemi, who in difficult moments of adolescence and hard work of encouragement and motivation to keep me focused on the path. I thank my friends who sacrificed time and energy to make this presentation possible, Professor Chris Haimaku, Dr. Tuji Lawal, Dr. Oni, Dr. Sheun Shanu. Only God can reward your labor of love and sacrifice to make this presentation possible. Mentors along the way are Professor A. Omibodu, a great scholar who many times has seen ability in me that I doubted and was always right. There are many stories to be told about our relationship that time will not permit me to tell. Professor B. L. Talak also confessed right to my scholarship as we work together in research and application in pregnancy. I thank Professor Motade for the confidence in me and always being there to bail me out of trouble. Professor M.T. Shokube and Professor Oguni are wonderful teachers, and I dare to call them friends. Dr. Odoni Mario, who never fails to applaud me with any two progress I make, always has my back. Dr. Kaede Avolabi, thank you for all the opportunities you gave me to grow in always challenging me to greater heights. Dr. Laide Amushuka, who was my first employer after my NYSC. I thank Dr. Amisa Dek Roju for giving me unfettered access to many of their resources. I appoint Professor Obeyemi at Blessed Memory, who was my first principal in secondary school, and Mr. Jerugbi, also of Fatima College. I thank all my teachers as listed on the slide. I appoint my beloved friends and colleague, Professor Okunlola, my head of department, who gave me his full support for this today. Professor Shinola Dokun and all other members of the department for their great support. My dear friends in other departments are well appreciated. The list of these people that impacted my life in my academic career cannot be exhausted in this acknowledgement. I acknowledge my shadow friends at Fatima College and at ISA, as listed in the slide. Dr. Bim Badeni and Dr. Wale Odugemi shared my NYC experiences with me. I acknowledge my classmates in medical school, Professor Jesse Otegbayo, the current Chief Medical Director of University College of Ibadan, Dr. Kayade Adepo, Dr. Joko Adeleye, Professor Muji Atalabi, Dr. Augustine Takure, Professor Fatai Fentola, Dr. Kumi Jeru, Dr. Kule Shokoya and Larry Johnson, and all members of 89 MBBS and BDS graduating sets. My research collaborators are Lima Shakostil, Ian Roberts, and Eni Balogun, and all other members of the team in London and Ibadan. I acknowledge my entire family, my aunts, my uncles, my cousins, Fatima family, Yinka Fajimi, she must be here, BC Shehu and Soji Alade. To my secretary, Tola, and our assistant along the way, I say thank you. I acknowledge my spiritual parents, Pastor and Mrs. Olubi Johnson and Sarah Johnson. They tell over me in word and prayer. My siblings, Abimbola, Akionla, Uraola, thank you for love and support over the years. Finally, I must acknowledge my dear wife, Dr. Onipe Olayemi, and my children, Inioluwa, Ayonfeoluwa, and Anoluwayemi. If anybody felt the pang of my work, you did. Thank you for your support and understanding. Thank you all for listening.
Thank you.